There's honey in the rock, water in the stone, manna on the ground, no matter where I go. I don't need to worry now that I know. Everything I need you've got. There's honey in the rock. Praying for the miracle, thirsty.
How sweet it is to trust in Jesus. I want to share something with you guys. This next song we're doing is called Same God. And I don't know what you've walked in today. You may have had the best day of your life. You may have had a really, really hard weekend. But no matter what you carry, our God is faithful. Our God is true. There's a time in my life where I walked with a lot of deceit, a lot of betrayal, a lot of grief. And the one thing that was constant in my life is that God was steady, he was faithful, steadfast, a faithful father who loved and poured out his love on me when I needed it the most. There's a line in this song excuse me. It says, I'm calling on the God of David, the one who made a shepherd boy courageous. I may not face Goliath, but I have my own giants. So whatever giant is in your life right now, whatever you're facing, there's always something, right? Always something. I just want you to give it over to God this morning. I want you to just sing and declare these words, that he's the same God who parted the Red Sea. He's the same God who raised Lazarus from the dead. He is faithful. He is true, unchanging. So y'all sing this out with us.
Thank you.
that you are unchanging, God. We thank you, Lord, that you are faithful. You stay the same, yet you can still surprise us. We just thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for your love that you poured out on us, God. We just love you right back. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
All right. Well, welcome. Oh, come on. Welcome. I'm glad you're here. There we go. Hey, we're so glad you're here this morning. Whether you're here in person or online, we would love to connect with you, especially if it's your first time. The best way for you to do that is to scan the QR code that's on the seat back in front of you, or online you'll find a link in the chat box. You can click on our digital connect card and fill out the information there. It allows us to get to know you a little bit. There's a bunch of helpful links, some more of those that we'll talk about. One of those is you can click on the one that talks about prayer. And we would love for you to do that. We'd love to partner with you in prayer so that we can pray for you and whatever it is that you need prayer for. As a staff, we meet every Monday and pray over those prayer requests. We also have people on a prayer team that pray over those each week. And prayer is something that's very important to us. So we would love to partner with you that way and let us know how we can be praying for you. If you, as we gather and we sing songs to honor God and we listen to what's going to be an incredible message this morning, if you consider Grace to be your home church, I want to also invite you to honor God with your giving. See, Scripture tells us that where your treasure is, your heart will be also. It means that you put God first in that stuff, that where your treasure is, you're going to put your time and your talents and resources into that stuff. And so today, as a way of putting God first, we want to invite you to give back to Him and to honor Him with your giving. There's a link for that in that link tree there. But also, if you're here in person, you can give and drop off something in the generosity boxes as you leave today. The last link I want to tell you about is our sermon notes. Those are there for you so you can follow along. I would encourage you today to take notes from the message. It was challenging. It's going to be challenging to you. Pastor Chris brings just an awesome word today. So join us as we continue our service. There's something in the water. Good morning. Welcome to Grace. I'm so glad you're here today. Those here in Paradise, those online. Actually, I met someone who normally watches online. They're here today. They normally watch online from California. So I'm welcoming all those others. If you're ever around, come. We'd love for you to join us in person as well. It is a great day to be here. And if you are new to Grace, my name is Chris. I'm one of the pastors on staff. And I want you to know that we are so glad you're here. We're hoping that you would come. This is a place that wants you to feel welcome, feel a place where you can belong. But ultimately, if you're just checking out the God thing, you're not sure what you believe, we want you to feel free to ask questions and to discover what God is and who He is and what He has for you. Because ultimately, my hope, our hope, is that you just experience God in the same way so many of us have. Because it's life-changing. Hey, today we're continuing a series called Something in the Water. If you missed last week, you can always go online, GF.Church, and check that out. Last week's main idea was simply this, that most of our struggles, the solution to most of our struggles is simply surrender. And so, man, if you're going through something, you're struggling through something, I would encourage you, go and check that out.
Now, as we get started, I just want to pause and pray and ask God to guide us in our time together. Father, thank you for that we get to be here. Thank you for being here with us. And Holy Spirit, I ask that you would speak and fill this place with your truth and your truth that changes our heart, changes our lives, and that Father, we would hear from you today. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. When I was a kid, one of my favorite places to go, I would say go eat, was Mr. Gaddy's. How many of y'all had a Mr. Gaddy's, right? It was a game room that served pizza, right? It really wasn't about the pizza, let's be honest. It's like cardboard with cheese, right? But it was all about the games. But my parents wouldn't let us have, you know, a lot of quarters to play the games because that was a waste of money. But they gave us a few. And then every now and then I would take my own quarters to play, right? But what I loved is when my friends would have their birthday parties there, because we'd get a whole cup of tokens and we'd go in there, and there was this one game that I loved to play. It was called Rockin' Bowl. And you would basically, listen, there's lots of games, but this is like the only game I would spend my time on. You would roll the token down this ramp and try to hit targets that were spread out at the back of the game. And if you hit the target, it gave you a lot of tickets. It was like high risk, high reward, because if you miss a target, you got nothing. But I'd spend all my time, I would blow through those tokens on it, and I'd get all the tickets I could, and I'd go up to the ticket counter, and I'd see the giant prizes on the top shelf behind the ticket counter, and they'd add up my tickets, and I was nowhere close to the prizes I really wanted. And I'd end up walking away with like half a dozen Laffy Taffys and some spider rings to prank my sister with, all right? But you know, I would spend all this time, energy, and effort, and I'd walk away with nothing of value really to show for it. And I think if we're not careful, we could be in danger of doing the same thing with our lives. Because all of us have something that we think that we need to go after, that we need to achieve. Maybe it's a certain number in a bank account, because, man, that we would feel like our life was meaningful and successful, and we've made it, and it would provide security for us. And so we chase after that bank account. Or maybe it's a piece of property that we go, man, at some point, we're going to have that. And we're going to have made it. Maybe for some, it's a certain lifestyle that you've been watching on social media and you think, or on television, you think, man, if we, one day that's going to be us. Maybe for some, it's that relationship that you keep chasing because you're just looking for your soulmate, that one that's going to complete you. For some, it's just chasing after pleasure. It's the next high, it's the next party, it's the next sexual encounter. Because you think that there's this thing out there that will ultimately finally satisfy this thing inside of you that says, man, there's got to be more. And the reason we go after those things is because we're programmed from a very young age through the things that we watch, through the things that we listen to, through the social media that we scroll through, that, hey, that is where meaning and purpose and satisfaction is found. But the problem is that so often we find those things and it's not what we expected. I mean, what if we get what we want most, but then once we get it, we realize it didn't even matter? I was reading a book in seminary once called Don't Waste Your Life by a pastor named John Piper. And in it, he tells a story that he read through Reader's Digest of this couple who took an early retirement so that they could travel around on their 30-foot trawler collecting seashells and playing softball. And I thought, man, that sounds pretty nice to me. That sounds like a good way to spend the end of your life, right? But then he reframed it this way. He said, but imagine getting to the end of your only one, your very precious, only God-given life, and spending the last days that God has given you collecting seashells and playing softball, and then one day standing for God, and he goes, all right, to tell me how you spent the rest of your life. Tell me what you did with the days I gave you. And you go, God, look at my seashells. And for me, it reframed things for me because I thought, you know what? I don't want to get to the end of my life with just a bunch of Laffy Taffy. I don't want to get to the end of my life with a pocket full of shells as I rally around the family. If you know, you know. I don't want to get to the end of my life and realize the thing that I thought I wanted most didn't even matter. Because here's what I know. I don't have a clue how long I'll live. I know that the goal has never been to stay here forever, all right? The goal is to be there. But I don't know how long I'll get to be here. But here's what I do know. Whatever days God does give me, I want them to matter. Don't you? I want them to make a difference. I want them to mean something. There's a quote by Thomas A. Kempen that I read several years ago. It's become like a life quote for me, that it is vain to wish for a long life but care little about a life well lived. Think about that. It is vain to wish for a long life but care little about a life well lived. So how in the world can we care about a life well lived? How do we live a life well? How do we make sure our days matter? And today I think we see how in a story we're going to look at in Luke chapter 5. If you have your Bibles, you can go there. If not, it'll be on the screen here in just a second or on the notes app. But in this, there's a guy named Luke who writes this down. He was a doctor. He's an eyewitness of Jesus' life and good friend of Paul, who wrote much of the New Testament. So he writes a very detailed account of Jesus' life. And he writes on the story of a guy named Simon or Peter. Jesus renamed him Peter. So if I say one or the other, don't be confused. It's the same guy. Just consider it his nickname, okay? All right. He writes this story. And I think in this story, we find what it takes to live a life of meaning and purpose. Check this out. Luke chapter 5, verse 1 says, "One day, as Jesus was preaching on the shore of the Sea of Galilee, great crowds pressed in on him to listen to the word of God." Now, back then, they didn't have a Bible. They didn't have, the scrolls were in the temple. Like, Jesus is just teaching, and it's the very word of God coming out of his mouth, and it's words that brought life and meaning. People are just crowding around going, "Man, this, whatever he's saying, we need more of that." So the crowds are pressing in around him. He says Jesus noticed two empty boats at the water's edge, for the fishermen had left them and were washing their nets. I think that these empty boats could represent this for us today, is that earthly pursuits will ultimately lead to emptiness. That the things of the earth that we think matter and that we're going to go after and they're going to satisfy will ultimately lead to emptiness. Now, these are two professional fishermen, all right? This is what they were raised to do. This is their livelihood. Since they were young, they've been on a boat. Their dad's showing them how to fish. This is what they did. It was part of who they were. And the empty boats meant that they came up short, that they'd failed to catch anything. And I think often it's life's failures that helps expose the emptiness in our life. Because when things are good, we sometimes can ignore it and deny that it's even there. The reality is, this doesn't mean it's not there. It just means that we don't feel it as much. See, as humans, we are hardwired to fill that emptiness with something that will satisfy. A guy named Charles Spurgeon said it this way. He was a theologian. He said, "Men are in a restless pursuit after satisfaction in earthly things, that they are constantly at it, going after whatever they think will satisfy." He says they will exhaust themselves in the deceitful delights of sin. They will spend all their energy, efforts, time, their entire life going after things. And it says deceitful delights of sin, meaning that the sin promises something that never delivers on. It promises satisfaction. It promises meaning, but it will never deliver on. It's just a deception. It says, and in finding them all to be vanity and emptiness, they will become very perplexed and disappointed. See, we're all in danger of pursuing things that we think will satisfy, that will put this fill this emptiness inside of us. It's like the satisfaction tank, right? The problem is the further and faster we go chasing after earthly things, the faster that tank gets empty, the less satisfied we become. You know, Jesus even warned us about this in a sermon that he preached that one of his closest followers, Matthew, recorded. He said this in Matthew 6. He says, "Don't store up treasures here on earth." This is Jesus talking. "Where moths eat them and rust destroys them and where thieves break in and steal them." He says, man, all these things are temporary. They're not going to last. And even if you make it to the end of your life with them, guess what? You don't get to take them with you. So he says, instead, store up your treasures in heaven. Send your treasures ahead. They'll be waiting for you. He says, store up treasures in heaven where moths and rust cannot destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. Don't chase after things that are temporary. Chase after things that matter, things that will last. He says, wherever your treasure is, There the desires of your heart will be also. He's saying, man, whatever you think is most important, whatever you think will satisfy, will be what directs, will be what steers and directs your life. It'll be what drives you. Whatever you think, it will bring satisfaction and fill the emptiness. And Jesus himself is saying, don't chase after things that don't last. But yet we chase after filling the bank account. And maybe we've got good intentions of saying, man, we want to be able to pass down a good inheritance. And I just want you to know, I want you to hear me on this, is that it is possible to pass down a bank full of money and yet leave the next generation spiritually bankrupt. Because we chased after the wrong thing. Jesus says, hey, instead of that, just do this. Seek, go back, the kingdom of God above all else. Make that your number one pursuit. Make that the thing that matters above everything else. Seek his kingdom above all else and live righteously. And he will give you everything you need. Listen, if you chase after earthly things, he says, man, they're not going to last. They're just going to leave you empty. But if you just seek me above all else, I'll fill you to overflowing. Let's get back to the story in Luke chapter 5. Jesus stepped into the empty boats. Right? He says, stepping into one of the empty boats, Jesus asked Simon, its owner, to push it out into the water. So he sat in the boat and taught the crowds from there. See, one of the things that we need to realize is that those empty boats probably represent for us this idea that there's this emptiness. But Jesus says, I want to step into your emptiness. And he asked him, hey, I'd like to step into this empty vessel and give it purpose and give it meaning. See, if we want to, Jesus wants to step into our emptiness, but we have to let Jesus into the emptiness of our life. Think about it. When he stepped into the empty vessel, there was nothing there. There was nothing to show for all the work and the toil. But then he stepped into the vessel and he gave it meaning and purpose. No longer was it a fishing vessel. It was now a platform to tell others about the goodness of God. He wanted us to step in to our emptiness, but you know what? He doesn't force his way in. He asks and he lets us, he wants us to let him in, to invite him in. God used John to say it this way in Revelations 3. He says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and eat with him and he with me. He says, I'm standing at the door and I want to come into your life and I want to have a real relationship with you. That's what that eating together. It's not that he just wants some ribs, all right? He's saying, I want to come into your life. And I want you to have a relationship with me. I want you to know me, and I already know you, and I just want you to let me in. It makes me think, if you've ever been to a concert and you're just waiting to get in, and you just can't wait, and the second those doors open, people jet inside. I feel like God is eagerly waiting, anticipating the moment you'll just say, all right, God, will you just come into the emptiness of my life? Will you just step in? I'm tired of trying to do it my own way. See, that's why Jesus came. Jesus came to the earth to step into our emptiness and to fill us and to give our lives meaning and purpose. Story goes on in verse 4. It says, when he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, now go out where it is deeper and let down your nets to catch some fish. Now, let me tell you, this was an odd request. This didn't make sense to Simon. Because this isn't how you fished. I mean, they were raised to fish and they knew how to fish. They were basically commercial fishermen and no other commercial boats were out there fishing in the middle of the day because the way you fished was you fished in the shallows at night. So here's this guy who was Jesus, raised by a carpenter. Maybe he's a weekend warrior fisherman. He's trying to tell us how to fish. What does he know about fishing? I think so often we like to compartmentalize our faith and think that, all right, God, we'll let you talk to us on Sunday, but hey, we got work figured out. We got our lives figured out. We saw how our parents did it and how they taught us to do it. And we've got this other area. I mean, what does God know about business? What does God know about parenting? I think he probably knows a lot. But so often we try to compartmentalize it. And he's saying, hey, I want to step in. I want to step into to not just your life, but every area of your life. He wants to change the way you work. He says, hey, I want you to go out deeper. You just trust me with this. So this is how Peter responds. His master, Simon, replied, we worked hard all last night and didn't catch a thing. We came up empty. But then he says this, but if you say so. if you say so, I'll let the nets down again. Not because it makes sense, not because I see your strategy, Jesus, but if you say so, I'll trust you in this. I'll try it your way. See, one of the things we've got to do if we're going to let God in is we got to learn to listen to God. We got to learn to listen to his voice. And hear what he's telling us. See, not all of us have hearing problems. Many of us do because that's what happens when your body breaks down, all right? That's the effects of sin on our physical body. And not all of us have hearing issues, but most of us struggle to listen. See, hearing is passive. Listening takes intention. It takes effort. It takes a desire to understand. And I'm not telling you this from someone who's good at it. I'm telling this from someone who's not very good at it. Just ask my wife. All right, she'll tell you, but if I'm going to understand, if I'm going to truly listen to my wife, I've got to turn off some things inside my brain, all right? Because I get so distracted. I'm distracted about thinking about things that I'm doing or things I'm going to do or things that I've been doing or I'm distracted about the game on television or what the kids are doing. If I'm going to understand and listen to my wife, I got to turn off the noise. And I've got to focus with the intention of understanding. And the same is true with God. God wants to talk to you. Think about this. The creator of the universe wants to talk to you. He's talking to you all the time. The problem is we don't hear it because there's so much noise. We fill our lives with noise. There's always some kind of noise on. We turn on the television not to watch it, just to have noise. We turn on the radio just to have noise. We can't stand the silence, but yet it's the noise that so often keeps us from hearing God's voice. And then there's competing voices. The voices of those around us, the voices of the people we listen to, the voices of the people we follow on social media. And then there's the voice of the enemy. And sometimes he uses other voices. Sometimes he just speaks into our thought life and gives us thoughts that don't align with God's truth, but yet we think about and we mull over it and we believe it and we hold on to it. And then there's the voice of God, the voice of truth that changes everything. But to hear it, we've got to turn off the noise. We got to learn to get quiet and ask God to silence the voice of the enemy so that we can hear his voice. And it's not easy, and it takes time to learn to do that. We talk about it in our grow classes. If you've never been through our grow classes since we redid them, I would encourage you to go through them. Because we talk about this. It's essential to fully following God. But here's what I know. It may be difficult at first, but the more you learn to do it, the easier it is to hear his voice. Growing up at my sporting events, when I was playing sports, I could almost always hear my mom's voice above everybody else's. And not always because she was the loudest. I mean, sometimes she was. Not always because she was loudest, but because her voice was most familiar. And the more we begin to hear God's voice, the more familiar his voice will become, and the better we'll understand what he's wanting us to do. Now, once we learn to listen to God's voice, we've got to learn to be willing to do whatever he tells us to do. And one of those things is we've got to leave the shallows. We've got to be willing to leave the shallows and go out where it's deeper. Our high school group is about to go to camp at Panama City Beach. It's one of the best camps that I've ever experienced in my time of student ministry. Not just because it's at the beach. The beach is a plus. But it's a very good camp. But here's one of the things that I discovered anytime you go to the beach. Is that there's different kind of beach people, right? There's the people who go in, they'll get their feet in the water, maybe their ankles, maybe their knees. But they're not going any further than that. Why? Because there's something in the water, right? Then there's the people who will go in waist deep and maybe even up to the chest, maybe all the way up to their shoulders, but they are definitely not going further than where they can touch and they feel like they're in control. And I don't know what they think they're doing because if you watch Shark Week, that doesn't even matter. And then there's those people who are willing to go out past the first sandbar and swim all the way out to the second sandbar. That's where I like to be. And here's the thing. You'll never experience the second sandbar if you're not willing to go beyond where you can touch. And some of you are going, that is fun. But you know, a lot of times we follow Jesus the same way. Some of us just want to go feet deep, ankle deep, knee deep, where we feel like we can still control. Because if you just get into your knees, it doesn't affect the rest of your body. If you just follow Jesus in the shallows, it doesn't affect the rest of your life. We want to still have control. We want to be where it still feels safe. We want to be where we don't have to make any major changes or trust anything. The problem is, if you only stay where you can touch, you will never know what it's like to fully follow God and the power and the incredible life that he has promised for you. You're never going to experience God's power in your life if you never leave the shallows. Look at what happened when Peter leaves the shallows. It says this, and this time, remember, they fished all night. It says, but and this time was different. This time their nets were so full of fish, they began to tear. A shout for help brought their partners in the other boat. It was filling up, and they didn't do this all night. I mean, first time, let the nets down, this starts happening? So they call their partners, y'all got to come get in on this. It says, and soon both boats were filled with fish and on the verge of sinking. See, Jesus said, hey, I want you to do it a different way. And that different way led to different results. He has a different way. And I wanted you to know that I get to benefit from this in my own life. I've experienced this in my own life. Because when I was 4 or 5 years old, there was a ministry group that came to my parents' church that radically changed our family. And I still remember it today because it changed everything about our family. It changed what we watched, what we listened to. It changed what my parents did. It changed their marriage. It changed the way they did finances. It changed the way they did their work and their business. It changed the way they parented. And because of the way it changed their life, it changed my life. And I experienced God at an early age. But better than that, I got to watch what it looked like to fully follow Jesus as I watched my mom and my dad go after Jesus, and it fully impacted my life. Listen, parents, you want to set up the next generation to succeed, to experience God's blessing and meaning and purpose? The greatest thing that you could do is say, listen, no matter what, no matter above everything else, I'm just going to fully follow Jesus. And I'm going to tell you this. I benefited. I got to experience the blessing of their obedience. And the next generation will too if you'll simply leave the shallows. And instead of saying, well, this is the way we've always done it, and this is the way I was raised, and this is the way the culture's raising people, and this is what culture says, you just say, God, what do you want to do? How do you want us to do it? And if you say so, we'll try it. We'll do it. And we'll believe that you'll fill it. They left the shallows. You know what's so great? It filled their boat. But it didn't just impact them. It impacted those closest to them too, right? It filled their boats too. Because you know when God starts moving in your life, you get really excited and you say, hey, you got to come check this out. You got to come get in on this. A different way led to different results. And I believe God wants many of us to do it a different way. And it's going to lead to different results. The story goes on. It says, when Simon Peter realized what happened, he fell to his knees before Jesus and said, oh, Lord, please leave me. I'm such a sinful man. And here's why he said, for he was awestruck. He was in awe of what God did. He was awestruck by the number of fish they'd caught, as were the others with him. Because here's the thing. When you experience God's power, it will change your perspective. It'll change the way you see things. You get this. If you need glasses, you understand this. Without your glasses, you can barely see something. But the minute you put the power of that lens in front of you, it changes the way you see. And when you experience God's power in your life, it changes the way you see things. It changes the way you see God. It changes how you see God and how you understand him in your life. You see, all of a sudden, he's not just this distant God who's out there somewhere. He's not a big guy in the sky or a colossal killjoy just waiting to strike you down when you mess up. That when you experience the power of God in your life, all of a sudden you experience the love of a perfect father. And I get it that sometimes our fathers here on earth aren't perfect. My kids don't have a perfect father either. But he is the perfect father. Imagine being loved by the perfect father. We experience the love of a perfect father. It changes your life. And he's a loving father who wants us to know him, and he made it possible. You see, the reason we have this emptiness is because we sinned against God. We did things our way instead of God's way. We rejected God and said, no, God, we trust ourselves. We don't trust you. And we went our own direction, and that welcomed sin and pain and heartache and destruction into our lives. But the worst part is it separated us from the only person that could ever satisfy our deepest need. But God loved us so much that that's why he sent Jesus to make a way. See, we had a penalty that had to be paid for our sin. There was punishment. And the only one who could take it away was a perfect sacrifice. And so Jesus came. He sent his only son to the earth to take away the sins of anyone who would believe in him. This is how Jesus said it in John chapter 3. Many of us are familiar with us with this verse. It says, for this is how God loved the world, that he gave his own one and only son. He didn't just say he loved us. He demonstrated by giving his one and only son so that everyone who believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. Anyone who believes in him, believe that Jesus died to pay our penalty, that he rose from the grave and said, listen, I'm done trusting my way. I want to trust your way. Now, here's the verse that follows that many times we don't see. Is that God sent his son into the world, not to judge the world, but to save the world through him. Listen, Jesus didn't come to condemn you, to judge you. He came to save you. So if you feel guilt or shame or judgment or condemnation, that is not from your loving father. That's from the enemy that wants to do everything he can to drive you away from the love of a perfect father. If you would just believe in him, put your faith in him, He will save you from the penalty of your sin. But better than that, he doesn't want to just save us. He wants to give us a meaningful life. Later in John 10:10, Jesus said it this way. He said, the thief, talking about Satan, comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. How does he do it? By lying to us, promising us satisfaction, meaning, and purpose through other ways than God's way. But it's a lie. It's deception, because instead, he just wants the worst for you. Instead, he says, Jesus said, I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. This week when I looked up this word in the original language of abundantly, this is what it meant. It's pertaining to a quantity so abundant as to be considerably more than what one would expect or anticipate. Think about that. Jesus wants to give us a life that is far greater than we could ever imagine for ourselves or anticipate for ourselves. A life so much full of meaning and purpose and satisfaction that we could ever imagine experiencing. Here's what he's saying. That fully following is what leads to abundance. It's what leads to meaning. Isn't that what we're looking for? Isn't that what our souls, the deepest place in our hearts are looking for? See, I think this is why so many people can walk away from faith. It's because they stayed in the shallows and they never experienced that. Because I believe once you leave the shallows and you go into the deeper and you fully follow God, you can never go back. Because the life is so much better. That doesn't mean that you won't have problems. It just means that he changes the way you see those problems. And that he's with you every step of the way through those problems. That fully following leads to abundance, and it changes the way that you see God, but it also changes how you see yourself. See, Peter goes, hey, get away from me, Jesus. Like I don't belong around you. Now, I don't think he was actually asking Jesus to leave him, because they're in a boat, and I don't think they're asking Jesus to jump over and swim to shore, okay? I think what he was actually saying is, I can't believe you would do this for me, Jesus. I can't believe you would love me in this way. And that's the thing. When you experience the love of God, it is far greater than you could ever imagine, because you go, well, I can't believe a God that I have offended, that I have rejected, could love me in this way. I don't deserve it. And that's what's so amazing about God's grace, about God's love, because no one deserves it. Yet he loved us anyway. And when we begin to experience that love, it changes our identity, because now our identity isn't based on our accomplishments or what we do well or achieving the right things. Now our identity is based on the love of God, what he's already done for us. Listen, you have worth, you have value, you have purpose, you have meaning, not because you're good at what you do, but because what God has already done for you. And when you begin to experience your real identity, the identity that God has given you, no longer is success what it used to be. Success is no longer about filling the boat. It's simply about following Jesus. And here's the thing. Jesus may not always fill the boat, but as long as you are fully following Jesus, you did not fail. It changes how you see God. It changes how you see yourself. The story wraps up with this. It says, Jesus replied to Simon, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you'll be fishing for people. I'll give your life meaning and purpose. You'll do something significant." And as soon as they landed, they left everything and followed Jesus. They fully followed. But I love what he says. He says, don't be afraid. See, if we're going to experience the fullness of life, the abundance of life, we've got to refuse to be afraid. Because fear is a very controlling emotion. That's why politicians use it. Just wait for all the political ads. The other opponent will always be the guy who's going to end the world, all right? Whoever that is. Why do they do that? Because they know that fear is a very controlling emotion and they can control you with it. Do you know the enemy does the same thing? Because he wants you to be afraid that fully following Jesus, that if you follow Jesus, you'll be afraid of what you leave behind. You'll be afraid of missing out. You'll be afraid of what you have to give up. You'll be afraid that God doesn't have your best interest in mind. You'll be afraid that, what if I fail? What if I start and I fail? The same God who saved you is the same God who can pick you back up. And fear is a tool of the enemy that keeps you from experiencing the abundant life that God has for you. We just simply have to refuse to be afraid so that we can fully follow Jesus. And if we do, listen, if we do, it changes everything. Because now it changes the way you love and serve your spouse, because now it's not about if they respond or how they treated me. It's about, God, if you said so, if this is how you want me to treat and love and serve, I'll do it. It changes the way you do your finances, because you begin to look at it as just temporary possessions that God has given you to leverage and use to help others know him. It'll change how you work, because work will no longer be about making money. It'll be about making a difference and helping others know him. It'll change the way you parent. Your greatest desire will no longer be that your kid like it's a D1 scholarship or goes pro or becomes a doctor or makes lots of money. That now your greatest desire will be simply that your kid would know and follow Jesus and be used by him to build his kingdom. It'll change how you finish your life. Listen, it's great that maybe you get to retire one day, but never retire from ministry. That at the end of your life, you go, man, now that I don't have to work, now I can do more for the kingdom of God. Now, instead of just doing things here or there, I get to sprint to the finish. And that my last days will be my best days. Because here's what I know. I don't want my life to be a full pursuit of something that turns out to be Laffy Taffy. I want my life to have meaning and purpose. I want my life to matter. And here's what I know. Here's what I know. Is that earthly pursuits will only lead to emptiness. But fully following Jesus will lead to an abundance. So what do you need to do to fully follow Jesus today? Do you need to just learn to listen to him? You need to learn to listen to his voice instead of going, man, this is the way we're supposed to do it. This is the way we've always done it. Maybe you stop and go, all right, how do you want us to do it, God? What does it look like to parent in a way that honors you? What does it look like to do business in a way that honors you? What does it look like to go through marriage in a way that honors you? Maybe you need to leave the shallows by simply learning to trust him and quit trying to control things. Maybe it's by just stepping into his church and saying, God, we want to be fully all in with your church. We want to serve. We want to give. We want to invite other people to come and get in on what God is doing. Maybe for you, you need to go through the Grow classes so you can see what that looks like to fully follow God and get some of the tools that we offer. Maybe you need to be like Peter, who's willing to leave it all behind, all that's familiar, and fully follow Jesus. You know, maybe for today, for you today, it's just simply taking that first step of letting him into your emptiness. Where you admit, listen, I've tried other things, but I know in my soul that you're the one that I need. I believe he's talking to you right now. And you'd say, listen, I realize I've sinned. I've done things wrong. We all have. Everybody's sinned. No one sins so little that you don't need God's love, and no one sins so much that God's love can't save you. You just have to admit, I've sinned, but I believe Jesus paid the penalty of my sin, that he rose from the grave, and I don't have it all figured out, but I know you. I need you. I need you to come into my life to save me, to change me, to give my life meaning and purpose. And you know what? If you'll just tell him that right where you are, he'll do it. He'll step into your emptiness, but it's just the beginning. It's the beginning of one of the greatest journeys that you could ever imagine. Today, as we close, I'm going to ask everybody to bow their heads and close their eyes. And today, if you say, man, that's the decision I need to make. I need to ask God to come into my emptiness. I want to lead you in a prayer. Prayer is just talking to God. There's no magic prayer. But I want to lead you through a prayer simply as a way of marking that decision today. So if that's you and you go, man, I need Jesus to step into my life. I need to follow him. Tell God something like this right where you are. God, I know that I've sinned. I believe Jesus died to pay the penalty of my sin, and that he rose from the grave. I don't have it all figured out, but I know I need you. So I'm asking you to come into my life through your Holy Spirit's power. You would save me and change me and lead me to a life full of purpose and meaning and satisfaction. The heads bowed and eyes closed. Today, if you'd say, man, I know God's telling me today that I need to leave the shallows, that I've stayed in the shallows of my faith for far too long. Today, you would say, man, that's the decision I need to make. I know God is asking me to leave the shadows. Right where you are, just will you real quick raise your hand? Let me see you. I want to pray for you. Okay, I see you. Yeah. God's telling you, yeah, love it. Awesome. Yeah. Awesome. I want to pray for you right now. Father, will you give us the boldness and the courage to leave the shallows? For those of you speaking to their life right now, God, I pray that they would hear your voice and they would just do it, not because it always makes sense, but because you said so. And God, they would step out and trust you. And God, that as they do, you would fill their life with meaning and purpose, with an abundance like they'd never experienced before. God, I pray that you move in power. And I ask this in Jesus' name, and we give you all the glory. Amen.
Awesome. Thank you, Chris.
Wrote something down. I hope today challenged you. If you made a decision today, just then, or you said, hey, I want to step out of the shallows, maybe what you need to do is figure out what your next step is. That could be a grow class that we have. Chris talked about that in his message. It could be in following God in baptism. We celebrate baptism because we're celebrating a decision to follow Jesus and making that public. And we celebrate baptism at the end of every month. This particular month, we're not doing that. Our next baptism is going to be on July the 3rd. But if that's something that you're interested in and that you want to take that next step in baptism, please let us know. You can fill that out, a baptism card from the links that we talked about on the QR code, or you can talk to somebody in the hub. But we would love to celebrate that with you. As that's coming up. Next week is Father's Day. Father, so don't forget, it's Father's Day next week. You know, we always make a big deal on Mother's Day, but Father's Day is important too. And we're going to have a special guest next week. John Kitna's going to be here, former NFL quarterback. A lot of you guys probably know who that is. But don't miss next week. Father's Day weekend is going to be incredible. And guys, if you like bacon, we got a special treat for you next weekend as well. So come back for that. And then coming up, July the 1st, the biggest community event that we do of the year is Freedom Fest. Freedom Fest 2022 is going to be incredible. It's a lot of fun. There are thousands of people on our campus, and we would love for you to partner with us in that. If nothing else, show up and invite somebody to come be a part of it. It's a free event. They can come just experience a lot of fun for the whole family, live music, inflatables, lots of games, big fireworks show at the end, food trucks. It's going to be really, really incredible. If you want to take a step past that, other than just showing up and inviting somebody, it takes a ton of people to pull it off, and we'd love to have your help. There's a place to sign up to help on the links from when you scan that QR code, or in the atrium today, you can sign up out there, say, hey, I want to help for an hour while I'm here. There's a ton of ways to do that. It takes a bunch of people to pull this event off. It's going to be absolutely incredible. Hey, God bless you guys. Have a great week.